thank you all for being here. My name is Thomas Franzen, and I'm a recent graduate from SUNY Oneonta. I must admit, I do feel a bit out of place at a fisheries conference. I'm an invertebrate guy myself, but we all can't get lucky at fisheries. The way I got involved with this project was actually through a project I was involved in as an undergraduate on freshwater pearl mussels, which doesn't really sound like it goes with eels, but it's actually a driving factor behind this kind of stocking effort. So, the American eel is a fish native to the Susquehanna watershed. It's a catadromous fish, so it must move between fresh and salt water to complete its life cycle. And unfortunately, due to extensive damming throughout the watershed, the fish's movements have been impeded, resulting in its extirpation from much of the Susquehanna River. Between 1936 and 1980, eels were stocked above these four main hydroelectric dams in Pennsylvania, and in recent years, eel stocking has resumed. Some of those eels actually migrate to New York, but due to extensive damming throughout the watershed, particularly around the Binghamton area, the eel populations in New York still remain very low. There have been a number of commercial and ecological issues caused by the decline of the eel. The eel fishery in New York was a huge industry, so the collapse of that fishery had tremendous economic impacts. Ecologically, the predator role of the eel is missing, so that of course has impacts on both invertebrate and invertebrate communities. The eastern Olympic eel, which is the most abundant freshwater mussel in the Atlantic river systems, has also been impacted by the decline of the eel. This is a picture of one of our, an Olympic eel from one of our study populations. You can actually see one of our tags on there. So as you can see in this diagram, freshwater mussels have a larval life stage called Leucidia. Leucidia are obligate parasites, so they attach to a host fish, usually on the gills, and then metamorphosize into juveniles, and then drop off into sediments and mature into adults. In the Susquehanna River, the only suitable host fish for Leucidia is the American eel. So because the eel is missing from most of the watershed, eel gills are unable to successfully complete their life cycle, and they are unable to recruit new individuals. One of the ways we detect recruitment failure is by aging the mussels. The way we do this is we collect dead shells from our study sites. We measure the length of the shells, and then we cut a thin section with a jeweler saw. We then mount that section on the slide and view it under a dissecting scope and count the annuli. With that information, we've been able to make this figure, which is age in relationship to years, age in relationship to shell length. And from that, we're then able to make a prediction for the surviving Olympias in our study populations based on their shell length. So as you can see, all the Olympias in our study populations are decades old. So these are relic populations we're dealing with. And this indicates zero recruitment. One of the big questions we had to deal with was whether or not these relic populations are reproductively active. The way we did this was by monitoring one of our populations over the course of an entire breeding season. Specifically, we monitored Olympias Machino Creek, that's in West Oneonta, so about an hour from here. So at the start of the breeding season, we collected males and females that had sperm and eggs. Later in the season, we collected females with fertilized eggs. Subsequently, we collected individuals that were breeding Leucidia. And finally, we collected Leucidia in water samples. This is actually Matita Creek Leucidia that we collected. So these animals are reproducing, but we're still not seeing any recruitment. Recruitment failure can be caused by multiple factors. Ammonia has an impact. Isolinity can cause it. However, all of our research is indicating that the absence of eels is the primary cause. This figure here is estimated time to extirpation for the Aptico Creek Olympias. We have population abundance here and then here on the bottom. These are three distinct models. The top one is a static model, the middle is a dynamic model, and the bottom is an average of those two models. The static model assumes that the parameters are the same across all the sampling intervals, and the dynamic model assumes that there's fluctuation in the parameters. The solid line is the mean, and the dashed line is 95% confidence intervals. The way we generated these models, we used R, and we estimated population abundance for the Aptico Creek Olympio population. We used marker capture techniques for reproductive phenology studies. This was very straightforward. And we also kept track of the dead animals we that study. So we were able to estimate the approximate death rate of the population, which allowed us to make these predictions. So clearly, there's a difference between static and dynamic models. However, whichever of the three models we look at, they're all saying that within a relatively short amount of time, if zero recruitment continues, this population will be extirpated. So of course, these models are only for the Antigua Creek Olympios. However, because we're detecting recruitment failure throughout the upper reaches of the watershed, regional extirpation is likely not far behind these predictions. Eels docking in Pennsylvania has been shown to increase Olympio populations, so it is safe to assume that by reintroducing the eel to the upper Susquehanna, that will allow the Olympios to successfully complete their life cycle and bring these populations back from the brink of extirpation. PDC was initially hesitant to stock eels due to the presence of the nematode swim bladder parasite, Anglophilides crassus. Nice disgusting picture right there. Anglophilides crassus heavily infects eel populations, and it's not native, it's native to Asia. So of course, DEC doesn't want to introduce non-natives to our watershed, and their fish health policy explicitly prevents stocking fish infected with parasites. The swim bladder parasite is so prevalent in eel populations that almost half of the eels stocked in Pennsylvania are infected with this parasite. So it's pretty likely that some of the eels that migrate to New York from Pennsylvania have already brought this parasite with them, or if they haven't already, they soon will. So because of the immediate need of remaining Olympio populations, and because of the likelihood that the swim bladder parasite is already in New York waters and will soon be in New York waters due to natural vectors, DEC has agreed to make an exception to their no parasite rule. Of course, with this exception comes several stipulations. First and foremost, we will be stocking elvers, not the fully grown eels. The reasoning there is to mitigate the likelihood of exposure to the swim bladder parasite. Next, we will be deriving the elvers from the Chesapeake Bay area. It actually doesn't matter where we derive the eels from genetically because they have no genetic predisposition to any sites. However, DEC stipulates this location, again, to mitigate the likelihood of swim bladder parasite infestation. Next, we must test a sample of all of our eels for an entire suite of fish pathogens, and except for A. crassus, they must be disease and parasite free. And finally, we must monitor eel density and eel dispersal post-stock. So our current plan is to stock between 30 and 60,000 eels, across three locations. Those locations are not yet determined. We're making that determination based on the remaining Olympio assemblages and some other logistical concerns. This current stocking effort is approved for research purposes. So essentially, it's serving as a pilot program. Depending on how this stocking effort goes and depending on the results we turn into PDC, future justifiable stocking may be approved. So first and foremost, we expect to see Olympio recruitment. The immediate need of these animals is the driving force behind this current stocking effort. And all of our research indicates that by reintroducing this fish, these animals will be able to successfully recruit. We of course expect to see change in the fish community because we're reintroducing a predator. We also expect that the eel will prey on the invasive rusty crayfish, thus suppressing its numbers and allowing native crayfish densities to prevail. Rusty crayfish are voracious. They chew up everything on the riverbed, including aquatic plants. So because they're killing aquatic plants, that increases erosion and increases water quality. So by suppressing the rusties, that will allow the aquatic plants to grow unimpeded, thus decreasing erosion and increasing water quality. As yet another bonus to eradicating the rusty crayfish, that will allow the yellow lamp mussel to successfully recruit. As you can see in this picture, there's all these barbels coming out of its mantle here. Those barbels are how the animal reproduces. I mentioned that the rusties chew up everything, that includes these barbels. So by suppressing the rusties, that will allow the lamp mussel to reproduce unmolested. So this current stocking effort is a huge undertaking. However, it's really just the tip of the iceberg in terms of the actual work that has to be done. A lot of the work is going to come from the post-stock monitoring. First and foremost, we will be closely monitoring Olympio recruitment as well as lamp mussel recruitment and just freshwater mussel recruitment in general. It would be very interesting to see how a variety of mussel species respond to the reintroduction of this fish. As stipulated by the EDC, we will be closely monitoring yield dispersal and densities post-stocking. And similarly, we'll be monitoring dispersal and density of the soil by entire site. We'll be also monitoring the dispersal, we will also be investigating the American eel's immunological response to swim bladder parasite infestation, as well as the eel's immunological response to Neoplasia parasitism. We hope that by understanding how the eel responds to Neoplasia, that will elucidate what makes the soil the host fish for Lipios, and that may help us identify other suitable host fish that we can stock in the future to make the Lipios less dependent on the eels. And finally, we'll be closely monitoring both new and invasive crayfish densities. Any questions? Yes?
Just answered my one question about the Lipios. Is that specialized? That they, all you deal is the only host fish right
now? Yeah, four Lipios in the Susquehanna. Other Lipios populations can be able to utilize other host fish, okay. But recent research is indicating that Susquehanna Lipios are specific to that.
You're not finding a group in that one?
Yeah. Yes.
Who's going to be doing all this monitoring?
A whole lot of people. The mussel work is going to be done by Paul Ward. Some of the fish monitoring is going to be done by Dan Stitt, who's actually one of the organizers of this conference. The immunological stuff, so Stephanie O'Yandre, will be working on that. Same with the work on the soil bladder parasite and the crayfish. I believe a faculty at Harvard is going to be working on that. Yes?
So you showed that the population is around 50 years old, so the last recruitment that was about a year ago. The dam's closed a long time prior to that, so the 19s. How did that recruitment event occur?
That's a great question. Some of the eels from Pennsylvania that they stopped in 1936 and 1980 have been able to migrate. So we see some recruitment from that. I'm sure there are other factors involved. If you'd like to contact Paul Lori, he would be happy to talk to you all day about mussel recruitment. He'd probably give you a much better answer. Anyone else? Yes?
Just so I know, there was historical stocking of eels from Pennsylvania.
Originally, it was in the 70s. Yeah.
Right.
So that was
the other question is, there are eels in the upper watershed now.
Yeah, well,
do you think the numbers are just way too
low? Yeah, exactly. It's some of the eels do manage to get up here. I think we detect the eels right up by a single week. It's just they're very low numbers, so it's not enough to to successfully reproduce. Yes?
When you mentioned stocking, you're talking about culturing in stocking or just capturing?
Capturing and stocking. So we're going to capture them in the Chesapeake Bay area and then release them. Any other questions? Thank you very much.
We're somehow